Software development, if you've been following the latest changes in intellectual property the last sort of 2 years, especially in the light of Apple, Samsung, and Alice, a great IP lawyer is probably as important as a great programmer today. So what Jeff was saying is extremely important. We're actually going to have a session coming up, probably two sessions from now, where we're going to actually review the intellectual property landscape of UX research and UX design. This will be obviously in light of the Supreme Court ruling in Apple Samsung and a couple of the other major rulings. We just had a very interesting copyright ruling yesterday, which we think will also impact intellectual property. Okay, so I'm just going to run through a couple of slides, and I'm going to turn over to Bonnie, my co-conspirator, sort of. And she will then finish up, and she'll introduce Margaret, who we're very honored to have tonight. This is sort of our second talk on information foraging theory. The first was by Peter Paroli from Xerox PARC. He did a great talk on sort of the structure of information foraging and how it applies to the web. And Margaret's talk is a little bit more applied, but also extremely interesting. Okay, so, a special thanks to Bloomberg. Bonnie works for Bloomberg. Has nothing to do with our sponsorship, I'm sure. And my firm also sponsors these events. Special thanks, obviously, to Meister and to Jeff for providing the background. As I said, the two co-organizers here, myself and Bonnie. Bonnie's a senior UX researcher at Bloomberg. And it took me a couple of years to twist Bonnie's arm to become the co-program director here. Okay, so just a little bit about our Masters of UX series. This is the third talk. We had Peter Paroli, we had Tom Tullis from Fidelity, right, who wrote the book on UX testing, probably the most widely read book in industry. So what we've done is gathered various leading experts to bring into this series. Our focus here, compared to, say, UXPA or some of the other popular events in Manhattan, is more science-based UX research. So we put a little bit more of a science spin on what we do. We have these sessions about every 2 months, and we have a big seminar planned for the summer, where we'll be 1 or 2 days, and we're going to do that on the latest technology and UX performance testing. So we'll have that should be an interesting series. And we obviously collaborate with other groups as well. Okay, so I think I'll turn it over to Bonnie, and she can finish up here.
This one over there. Just a few words about the New York Tech Alliance, which is a nonprofit industry association. It merged last summer officially of the New York Tech Meetup, which is a very large meetup. Hundreds of people go to see new tech, and the one question you're not allowed to ask is, what's your business plan? All you get to see is really cool stuff, okay? And the New York New York Tech Council. We should change the slide. And they had been talking for quite a while and discovered missions were very complementary and overlapped a lot to represent, inspire, support, and lead the New York technology community to create a better future for all. There are over 60,000 members of this New York Tech Alliance, so why aren't they all here today? Okay. And so a special thanks to Eric for creating this and moving this forward. So thank you, Eric, for having this ecosystem for us. Okay. So just a little bit more of education. Things like this, community building, workforce development, and advocacy. So Eric will go and testify at Congress or some places about those sorts of things. They have about 36 events a year, not just this meetup, but several others at CEO roundtables. There are annual memberships and sponsorships. Please see Eric for that. And here are our annual sponsors, more annual sponsors. You work for IBM, I work for Bloomberg. Okay, they're there. We have founding sponsors and a premier sponsor. Eric knows what all these words mean. Okay. And more sponsors, and we love our sponsors. So tonight's speaker, I would like very much to introduce Margaret Burnett. She is a distinguished professor at Oregon State University. We're very happy about that. The first woman distinguished professor in the School of Engineering. Where has Oregon State been? Right, okay, but yay, it's Margaret. All right, terrific. she's also a member of the Chi Academy. And that's, as Charles said about this research series, so far everyone we've had talking has been a member of the Chi Academy, and that's kind of what we're striving for. This is the premier scientific group in our field. Not that these folks don't have things to say to practitioners, because they do, and some are practitioners, like Tom, okay? They're not all academics with their heads in the clouds, okay? But they are very premier people in our field. And some of them, most of them, have actually founded some fields of our field, and Margaret's has founded a couple. One is end user software engineering. So how do all those Excel users program as if they're software engineers, because their code they write too and work, okay? It just doesn't look like code we think of, you know? So that's what end user software engineering is. How to get quality into the sorts of things that people don't think they need it. And the field, subfield of gender HCI. How does the user interface affect men and women differently, and how can we make our software so that it benefits everyone better? So with that, I'm going to turn this over to Margaret to tell us about developers need usability too, theory guided design of programming environments. And take away, Margaret.
I'm not sure if I can project loud enough or not, so hard.
I can hear you.
You can hear
and
me.
And I don't even have my hearing aid in.
Okay. Let's see, where can I put this where I don't fall over it? Maybe just somewhere. All right, yeah. So developers need usability too, a theory guided design. And the thing is, this is my soapbox. Theory makes such a difference in everything that we try to do that's practical. And so you'll see this soapbox kind of leaking through everything I talk about. So I guess I'll leave it for now and go on and you'll see it. But first, a word from our sponsors. part of this trip was made possible by the ACM's Distinguished Speakers Program. And so the ACM likes to send people who have volunteered to be speakers to various events where people are trying to learn, you know, some corner of the computing world they don't know already or want to hear more about. So thank you, ACM, and they always ask that I include that slide and that slide. So if you've never heard of ACM, you should know about it. It is the premier global community with a whole bunch of members in a whole bunch of countries, and their mission is to inspire you, so you have to be inspired, and advance the profession, so you have to advance and make a positive impact on the society. Please do that too. And solve tomorrow's problems. So those are your homework assignments for tonight. Thank you, ACM. Okay, so let's talk about the motivation for this work. So you have these programmers, and a lot of times what programmers are doing actually is not creating new code. They're maintaining something in some way. And it turns out, of course, as many people know, software maintenance is really high. It's actually a higher proportion of the software budget than creation in the first place. And part of that, here is a smaller fact that people don't necessarily know about, a huge chunk of that is navigating, just navigating. And so this number here, this 35%, this was one of the earliest studies on the cost of just navigating in the course of doing software navigation or software maintenance. And that was just the mechanics of navigating, you know, just moving the scroll bar and stuff. When you add in the sort of the thinking about navigating that goes along with it, there are studies that have shown more than 50%. Okay, so you got this huge cost of software, and we're blowing half of it on people just moving around. This is horrible, and this is, of course, a usability problem. That's what it is. So that's our motivation. And so when this was discovered, I don't know, 10 or 15 years ago, people started building tools to try to help with program navigation. And they worked. They were helpful. One of them is TeamTrax, which came from Microsoft Research a while ago. Don't try to read this. It's just that down here at the bottom, it's noticing that you seem to have some interest in things that members of your teams were interested in, and it tries to help you know where they went, to try to inform your navigation of knowing where you should go next. Another one was, there's another piece of it. Another one was called HippoCat, which was a forerunner of Mylan. And so that one was one of the first to use text comparison to help figure out where you might want to go. So it was using a handbill algorithm to look at the text of the places you've been and think about where you might want to go next. So those things worked pretty well, reasonably well. But the thing is, nobody really quite knew why they worked. But everybody had opinions about why they worked. So the TeamStruck thing, we looked at, you know, the people who built that, they had an idea. This is going to work because people are going to be helped by knowing where their team members went. And the HippieCat thing, the same thing. This is going to work, you know, because it's all going to be about this text thing. And so what they believed when they got these good results is that's why. It's because of our underlying reasoning engine. Okay? But there are a lot of other reasons why it could have worked too, and there could have been some pieces of the engine that made all the difference, and other pieces that were actually getting in the way of progress. But they don't know this. They just have a binary. Yup, it worked. So this is where theory can help. Okay? Because theory can help us understand, start from where the programmer's heads might be at this moment, and try to tie that stuff together with the environment that they're trying to operate in, so that we can understand better why something should work, what piece of the cognitive task it might be helping with, what the process might be, and isolate those things. Because if we know really why something worked, we can start developing principles that we can apply across tools. And so we don't have to say that one worked, that one didn't, who cares? We don't know why, let's go build another one. So that's my soapbox. I'll try not to do that soapbox too many more times. What information foraging does, you all heard, some of you heard from Peter Paroli before, and so it kind of comes down to deciding what's relevant. Okay, what do I need next? What's going to be relevant to my task? And so we're applying this to the world of programmer navigation. Peter applied it, well, to a couple of different domains, but he didn't get into programming. So if we can succeed at this, then information foraging theory is going to help us as sort of front-running usability people to predict where and how programmers are going to navigate and what reasoning process they're using to make those decisions. So let's try this. So for those of you who didn't come to Peter's talk or haven't heard of information foraging before, we built this algorithm called PFIS. And by the way, you'll see weird things on these fonts because at the last minute we transferred to another computer. So if you see things that are clunky and strange, believe me, they were once glitzy and beautiful right before we
they absolutely were.
Right before they did this conversion. Okay, so we built a cognitive model, a computational model of how programmers go about this called PFIS, Programmer Flow by Information Set. So, okay, fine. So in information foraging and in our world, there's this concept of a predator. Did Peter explain how this all started with researchers, biomedical or bio, some kind of biological, I guess, researchers who were studying animals in the wild? Did he explain that? It's so cool. So back in the 60s, there were these biologists that were trying to understand how wild animals behaved in the wild when they were hungry. So they got pretty good. And they built these mathematical models to predict what would happen. And they got pretty good at being able to predict where like a hungry cheetah in you know, the jungle is gonna go if there's a bird over here and a rabbit over there and a bunch of paths and meadows, you know. And then Peter, you know, about 20 years later said, I wonder if this same exact methodology could be used to predict where information seekers, people, will go on the web. And the same darn thing worked. I just think that's amazing. Don't you think that's amazing? Yeah, so that was kind of brilliant. And then at some point later, one of my students asked, could this stuff apply to the world of programmers trying to find what they need? So let's try that. Anyway, so you got a predator, there's a cheetah, he's so hungry. And in our world, it's a programmer, okay? He's hungry for information. actually, what here is what the cheetah is hungry for. And this programmer's debugging. He's not actually hungry for that bug, but the under the bug. So those are two key constructs. You've got the predator and the prey. And then the prey lives in these patches, okay? In the jungle, these are meadows or whatever. In the information space, they're chunks of the window, okay, or of a file or something. So the patches have information. And this is what it looks like in our world, a method or a window or something. And then we have scent and cues. And so cues, think of it as a misspelling of clues, they're things in the world that you can kind of figure out, maybe it's over there, okay? So cues are in the world. And so what we do is we sniff those cues. I see a bottle. Yep, smells like water, okay? I'm pretty sure this is gonna be a good thing for me to explore. So scent, cues are in the world, they're clues. Scent is in the head. We interpret what we saw and along the lines of relevance for what I'm after. Okay, so that's it. This is like the whole theater. Isn't that awesome? In our world, we do that with math instead of with our nose. And there's this information environment, out in the jungle, it looks like a beautiful green forest. and in our world, it's a bunch of windows and stuff like that. So how does our algorithm work? It's inspired by another algorithm that was done by some really awesome researchers, Peter Paroli and his colleague, Ed Chi, and some other people at Xerox PARC. And so we have these patches, those are the rectangles, and then there are these links among patches. And so this is like, for example, from Eclipse. And so it turns out in an environment like this, if you have a call to a method, you can click on it or hover over it or pop it up or something, and it'll take you to the method. So there, and so these are clickable links. Okay. So we take those into account, and then we think about the cues in the environment. For us, at least in this version of PFIS, they are words. So that's a cue, archive, because it's decorating a clickable link. It's giving us some idea of what we're going to get if we follow it. Okay, it's like a signpost, a clue. Okay, and then of course we, the programmers, are interpreting that. Is that relevant? So suppose we're starting with this bug. Okay, we need to archive feed items based on age. There's that word, archive. I bet that's going to be relevant. So I'm getting a lot of information sent. Okay? So what we do is we take a starting patch, so wherever it is they are, let's say they're looking at Maine, and then we propagate this relatedness. So we notice in our algorithm that the two words are the same, archive and archive. And so there's a certain amount of sent, and then we propagate it through all the links that are lying around here. So we just kind of push, and that's called spreading activation. And so as a result of that, we then predict where the programmer is going to go. So it's all based on these cues and scent. Do you buy this? Is this making sense? Okay, you're totally into this, but you should not be. I want you to say, no, what about hypotheses? Okay? No, everyone knows that programmers debug with hypotheses is what you should be saying, because that's the sort of going wisdom. So how do we bring these two thoughts together? Well, okay, a lot of people actually did a lot of research about that, and you know, I don't disagree that they're hypotheses guiding debugging. They create them, and then they confirm or refute them when they're debugging. You know, maybe it's this, maybe it's that. So I buy that. I totally believe it. And so, but what information foraging theory would be asking us to do, if we're going to use that, is it would be saying, don't worry, you can ignore those and it'll all be just fine, okay? Because information foraging theory is all about the environment and how the programmer is interpreting relatedness. There's just no thing in there for for hypotheses. And so this is the big question, is can we just ignore hypotheses, just use information foraging theory without dirtying it up with a bunch of new constructs, and still get there? Well, let's find out. So we recruited 12 professional programmers from IBM, and we gave them two tasks in a popular open source newsreader, which is called RSSOwl. It was popular at the time. I don't know how popular it is now. We did this a while back. Anyway, they had to fix a bug, and then they also had to develop a missing feature. And both of these were official issues in the RSSOwl issue tracker, so these aren't things we made up. These were real bugs. And we recorded and videoed and so on and so forth. And this is not one of our participants. This is an imaginary friend who could have been one of our participants. So here is, for example, the bug that they had to fix. The yellow thing is what they had to do. Create an option to delete feed items after a certain amount of time has passed. Okay, let's just pay attention to the words here. So we have create, we have option, we have delete feed items. That sounds like a lot of important words, delete feed items and time. Maybe there's something there. Okay, so now that's what we're supposed to do. We're going to wait for the picture. My public. Okay. All right, and here is the small list of our files. Which one shall we go to first? Do you want a refresher here? This is what we're doing. Okay. Raise your hands. Which one? Okay. So this is a lot. Obviously, we don't want to do this one file at a time. But fortunately, information foraging theory can help an algorithm try to predict where we might need to go or where we might go. So here's a news item. Let's see. It was about deleting items, so that might be relevant. Feed parser. That one, yeah. Feed, because there was feed. And archive, oh yeah, there's that one. And then date, that sounds like time. So a few kind of rise above. And then if we start to propagate it around, some other ones start to heat up a little bit too, because those files that had these important words, they had a lot to say, a lot of connections to some of these other ones. Okay? So that's what our algorithm does, is it tries to predict things like that. So how good is our algorithm at figuring out where people will actually go, what methods and files they're going to click on? Well, it turned out that this version of PFIS was pretty good. In fact, it was as good or better than combined human wisdom at figuring out where people would go next. So here's PFIS over all of those programmers and all of those navigations. And so it was doing pretty well, over 35% is its median there, okay, of predicting pretty well where people are going to go. If you took all the rest of the people and said, where did they go, kind of like the team, and used that as a predictor of the right place, you can see they're about the same as the algorithm. Those 11 other people, those humans, experienced programmers. So that's about the same. Their median's lower, their top is a little higher. Okay? And then if you just took one other programmer as a predictor of where some other programmer would go, that was pretty terrible. Okay? So this is pretty good. It's a good start. Digging down a little bit, we tried to figure out, well, what are good predictors of where people really went? So let's come back to this hypothesis thing. So what we did is we recorded them. And so we were able to extract every time they had a hypothesis. You know, I think it's going to be here. I wonder if this is the problem. Those are what those things sounded like. And we also looked at when they confirmed or refuted their hypotheses, and so we did that. We also looked at all their remarks about scent, and of course we looked at everything they clicked on and so forth. So we looked at the which, the why, the when, and the where. So let's look at the which. Which predictor was the best? Big, ugly graph. But here is random. So if we just threw the dice, okay, each time, we get this line where here are our true positives and here are our false positives. These are truthful things, it says, these are lies. And so you can see that if we are willing to tolerate 100% lies, random, will also get us all of the truths. Okay, but we don't want that, right? Because that's basically predicting that they're going to go everywhere. So what we'd really like is this ideal thing here, where it's getting 100% of the truthful places and no lies, okay? It's completely getting all the tuna out of the net and none of the dolphins, or the other way around, I don't know. Okay, so compared to this line and this ideal line, how did these various things do? Well, PFAS on the bug did kind of awesome. It is the closest to the ideal. So that's our predictor based on these words, just the words and where they clicked on. No hypotheses in there. So it's doing pretty well. If we added in the verbal hypotheses, the things they said were their hypotheses, look, about the same as we end up. Okay? So we do seem to be okay with completely ignoring the hypotheses and still be able to get pretty far with this. Here are some of the other things. The missing feature, we did not do nearly as well as we did with the bug. But okay, so what that's saying is, you know, the PFAS algorithm is working pretty well. So why? Why do we not need these hypotheses? Well, it turns out these are a whole bunch of our people, one at a time. And the blue is them talking about hypotheses over time. And the red is them talking about scent over time. And look at that. Almost every time they talk about hypotheses, they're also talking about scent. So the scent is basically capturing the stuff they're doing when they're working on a hypothesis. That's why we were able to ignore it. Okay? So, but you can see that the scent, there's a lot of times they're talking about scent, but not talking about hypotheses. So we can really get away with reasoning just about the environment and what somebody might think is related to that. And so this is very cool, because all of this data is in the environment. You have the information patches they're looking at. Those are on your screen, you know, and you know what they can see. If they scroll somewhere else, you still know what they can see. These are out there in the world. Okay, you've got the words. You know what those words are. Those are out there in the world. You've got the links. You know what all those are. Those are out there in the world. Everything's in the world. The only thing you have to guess at is how they are interpreting the cues. And we guessed by this spreading activation algorithm that I showed you, where we look at the word comparison and then push those that heat along the links. That's how we interpreted how they were figuring out scent. And it's the only thing we had to guess at. So this is very cool. We now don't have to have a whole model about how the brain works and so on and so forth. We can mostly reason just with the stuff in the environment. It's good for tool builders. I'm going to skip that one. When people talk about scent, basically in every debugging mode, okay? So if what they're doing is trying to get the lay of the land, they're talking about scent. If what they're trying to do is drill down into the part of the code they care about, they're talking about scent. If they're trying to pursue a failure, they're talking about scent. If they're trying to actually fix the thing, they're talking about scent. Everything, everywhere, they were talking about scent. It's pervasive. So it's not like it's just in one phase of the debugging, okay? It's all the way across the task. Okay, so where were they getting these cues? They could have been going to Google, they could have been going, you know, they could have been going all over the place, but where they were going mostly was code. And so what that's telling us is this is something else that's lying there accessible to us as tool builders, as user interface builders, because all we have to do mostly is look at the stuff that's in the code. And that's available to us, because that's mostly what the programmers were doing. So let's see. So let's see what we've learned so far. So we've figured out that this model, that's all based on information foraging theory, is as good or better as humans at predicting where people will navigate. We've figured out that we can safely ignore hypotheses because they get pretty well covered just by the scent thing. We figured out that it's pervasive, so there isn't just one mode of debugging that we have to worry about it in. And we've learned that most of the triggers, the cues that they're paying attention to, are right there in the source code. There are some other algorithms that I'm not going to talk about that came along more recently than that. People's goals evolve, so we built another model for that. There are ways to experiment with different prediction factors that one of our models took into account. And there's PFAS-V that looks at variance, which is what do you do if you're if you have more than one version of your code and you're trying to work with all three of them at once. Okay? Because then your patches look really similar. But I don't want to talk about those because I want to drill down a little bit and say, well, what can we really do with this then from a usability perspective? What where is something that we can really draw into our science, into our way of thinking about this scientifically, and sort of measure that or leverage it. So remember that navigating is expensive, super expensive. And so a question to ask ourselves is that too expensive? 35 to 50% of their time? I mean, yeah, it sounds like a lot, but maybe that's inherent, okay? So how would we find that out? If it's just inherent, why are we working on it? There's only, a little bit we can do. Is it not inherent? What's a lot lower bound of it? How low can we reasonably be expected to go? Well, information foraging theory can answer that question for us. Isn't that awesome? I think that's just awesome. Okay, so how does it do that? At the very core of SIND is this optimization problem. And so what programmers are, actually people are optimizers. Like when you were in school, if you didn't do your homework, then chances are there was a reason, okay? Chances are that you thought that the cost of doing that homework was not an acceptable cost for the amount of value you thought it would get you. Maybe you thought, okay, I've already got an A. I don't need to do this, and I do need sleep, okay? Or something, okay? So we're always optimizing. This is what we're trying to do, and programmers, of course, do that too. And so that's what they're trying to do when they navigate. If I go over here, what's the cost gonna be, and what am I gonna get out of it, okay, versus going over there. So that's what they're trying to do. But the problem is, they're not omniscient. They haven't been over there before. So they don't really know how much it's gonna cost them to slog through the swamp and battle the alligators to get there. And they don't know how much value they're actually going to receive when they do that. So the problem that they have to do is they have to guess at what the value is gonna be and what the cost is gonna be. So their attempt to maximize this is all about their expectation of what the value and cost are going to be. Okay, so given that, what we have to ask is, how well do the programmers actually do at this? How close are their expectations of the values and the costs to what really happens? That's the definition of SIND, okay? And so if we can answer this, we can tell us how well we're doing. So we looked at a bunch of professional programmers debugging a deficit in JEdit, and let's see here. And so they were going from patch A to patch B at some point, and every time they did that, when we replayed the video of them doing that, we asked them, why did you do that? What did you expect to get? Okay, so we're getting down their expectations of value. And then after they got there, we said, did you find what you expected to find there? And what did you learn? And we also said, we didn't ask them about cost, but sometimes they said, and oh boy, did that take me a long time. So we had some knowledge about their expectations of cost as well, and how true those were. So first, let's look at value. So we have three situations here. Either the value they got is more than they expected, or the value they got is what they expected, or the value they got is less than they expected. Okay? And so if what they got was necessary, related to their goal, and sufficient, that means perfect. This was necessary and sufficient and I'm done. Okay, this was the best value I could possibly get. Maybe it was necessary, but not sufficient. It didn't answer my goal. Or maybe it was just a big disappointment. So we looked at that and plotted everything, and what we found out is that about, see, that would be 34, yeah, about 50% of their expectations and values were wrong. Okay? What they expected to get is not what they got. This is a usability problem. What this is saying is we're not giving the programmers the tools they need to have any idea what they'll find when they get there. Okay? So this is bad. Why not? Here's a store. Oh, look. It's held. What's this say? Can you see that? What's that say? It says, buy brand name coffee makers right there in the store window. Isn't that cool? Yeah, I've been looking for a coffee maker, so I'm going to go in that store. Is it selling coffee makers, or is that just sold in advertising space that happens to be right on the store window? Okay. Let's say that in fact it's just sold in advertising space. Looked like it was advertising that store at those coffee makers, just by the placement where that sign was. That's not really what they intended. So we call this false advertising. Patches advertising prey they do not have. So we ran into this all the time when our programmers were navigating. Here's what it looked like for P8. P8 was looking for some connection to the actual deletion of text, but it was just an abstraction. So there was a method name. It said delete text or something like that. And it goes there, and there's nothing about deleting text. It just is an abstraction, an abstract superclass, an interface, a driver, something that doesn't actually do any of the work, okay? here's another example of it. I'm assuming that this one's not false advertising. This one is the synonyms problem. Cues that seemed related to the predator's goal, but they weren't. Here's an example. Somebody went to a method that had the word invalidate in it. They said, I'm assuming that invalidate means delete. It does not. So what's that about? There's this notion of vocabulary problems. It comes from both HCI and software engineering. Turns out that there's a huge number of variations in designers' vocabulary that are inherent in the English language. And even if you try to slice it down to software engineering terminology, it's still a huge variation. And so there are a lot of tools that use really sophisticated text relatedness algorithms like TF-IDF and latent semantic indexing and that sort of thing to try to find things that are related. And they work pretty well. They use synonyms to good effect. But there's a problem that our study pointed out, and that is these synonyms are great for reducing false negatives, okay? And so it helps you bring things together that you might miss, but the problem is they generate false positives too. And when they generate false positives, what they do is they greatly expand the developer's search space and lead them astray. So synonyms, yeah, so these synonym tools, they're awesome for getting rid of false negatives, but then they're causing this false positives thing that people aren't really paying much attention to. So those are two of the big problems that we ran across in people being able to predict the value that they would get when they went there. And so when there were those problems, they basically wasted their time going to those places, and that's driving the cost of navigation up. There was another one, cues that answered the wrong question, that I don't really have time to talk about. What about cost? So here we also had several categories. I think I'll just skip to some of the open questions. So our coffee maker, okay? So we go in the store, this is a different store, and we're still trying to buy this coffee maker. And this is called Prey in Pieces. So we go in and actually you can only buy this piece, okay? So you buy that, you buy the basket. And then you go somewhere else, and it turns out that at that other place, you can only buy this handle, And then you go somewhere else and you can only buy this canister, and somewhere else you can only buy that screw, and so on and so forth. And so you have to keep going to these places to get all the pieces that you need. And then you have to assemble them yourselves. This is prayed in pieces. And we ran into this all the time too. So here's an example of it. P's one goal was trying to understand the relationship between three different line variables in this debugging task. And so they started there. And what we wish they had done, among other things, was go down this dotted path that would have explained the relationship between screen lines and physical lines, which were two of the data structures in this thing. But they didn't. And we also wish they'd gone down this other thing that's a method that shows the relationship between physical lines and visible lines, but they didn't do that either. Instead, they went up, they went down, they went around, they went through, and finally, they gave up. They never got that information with all of those navigations. That's prey in pieces, okay? Here's another one. Supposing our coffee maker is fully assembled somewhere. So first, we go to Kmart. Okay? Kmart says, well, we don't have them, but Walmart might. So we go to Walmart. Walmart says, we don't have them, but Costco might. So we go to Costco. They say, we don't have them, but Rite Aid might. We go to Rite Aid. We might. We don't have them, but, you know, Penny's might. And we go to Penny's. We don't have them, but, okay? And each additional store you go to, man, you're feeling more discouraged, right? Okay? And finally, forget it. Okay? It's possible that at some point in this path, there will be a coffee maker. But we have been so negatively reinforced that, you know, we don't believe it anymore. Kind of like, has anybody ever had false labor? No? I've had false labor. I had false labor a whole lot of times with my first child. And long about the sixth time, I started to believe I was going to be pregnant the rest of my life, because each time, it wasn't the real thing. You know, I mean, yeah, you know, it can't be the rest of your life, but honestly, I've been so, you know, so punished with these labors that aren't labors. Okay, we saw this all the time, too. P3's goal was to find the method that deletes the lines. He started there. And the place he needed to go was there. And he went, and he went, and he went, and he went, and he gave up. Okay. This is the endless path problem. Okay, so what we can see here is that there are big problems with people being able to estimate the value they'll get, developers, and estimate the cost that they're going to have to pay. And so, where are the tools? Are they doing this for us? Well, it turns out that most of the tools, they give you some idea of what you might get one click away. But that's it. Okay, one click away. And so, for an endless path problem, like that one, okay, it's too myopic. You're here, you can see what you're going to get here, but you're not going to see how long the path is going to be. There's just not enough information to help you really decide what the cost and value is going to be. So there are these seven usability problems that actually are pretty much unsolved. Okay, that are real opportunities for us to try to get people's costs down. Okay, the false advertising problem, the synonyms problem, the frame pieces problem, and the endless path problem are four of them that I talked about. So let's see here. I think maybe what I'll do is, since it's getting late, is I've lost my ability to see. I guess I just have to look through. Something strange happened with this tool. I think I'll just get to the conclusion here, which is this one. So what information foraging theory brings to the table of usability for development is it brings us computational models, so we can build algorithms to try to predict where people will go in some particular environment. And so we can experiment with our environment and compare these predictions of where people will go. Okay. It brings design patterns. I skipped over that here, but it will be in the slide deck eventually. And so some of my collaborators have built a whole set of design patterns around information foraging theory, so that if you're trying to, say, for example, compute scent, There's a design pattern for it. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. And that's all publicly available. We have done a tool informed by information foraging theory that makes the cues more salient, easier to spot, so that they can do a better job of estimating the value in long distance things. And we've revealed these open opportunities for tools. So I think the conclusion here is, now that we know these things, we're better equipped. We have more ammunition to help us know what it's going to take to build truly usable and useful tools for developers, because we have these solid foundations to reason about what these tools should be like. So that's it. I have a bunch of papers listed up here in case you're interested in any of this. And of course, you can always go to my papers page and get even more if what you crave is reading about this. So I'm open for questions.
Looked at debuggers who are really good individuals and try to figure out what's different with them than the other people?
So they aren't really different, at least not in terms of the foraging. It's true that they are better at getting the bug fixed. But in terms of them being able to get to the bug they need to fix, If we take out of the equation familiarity with the code itself, okay, and put them all into an unfamiliar environment like this, if the cues are bad, the developers are just not going to be any better, okay? So, yeah, but one thing that we have been working on to factor into the equation is if they are trying to actually fix the bug with their fingers versus they're trying to onboard somebody else to fix the bug, we found big differences in the way they forage that, which is kind of interesting. We were bringing in notions from minimalist learning theory when we were thinking about that. And so it turns out that their prey are different. The people who are trying to fix the bug with their fingers, they want super low level details. And the people who are trying to onboard somebody else to fix the bug tend to be more interested in, shall we say, the lay of the land, the structure of the code and the way the pieces fit together. And so they spend time in different places in the code and they follow different kinds of cues, which we thought was really interesting. Yes. Oh, and I missed, wait, you were second. Sorry, you're third.
No, go ahead.
You're second.
Okay.
All right. You mentioned earlier Excel scripting. Did you do any sort of studies on code programmers?
Let's see, this is interesting. three answers. Okay. Answer number one, Paroli has. So his original studies were with the information analysts and web browsers looking at the web, not code. So he has done those. Answer number two, we are starting to look now at ordinary end users who have not code in front of them, but some form of logic, like say, for example, an intelligent agent trying to play a game on their behalf, and they're trying to decide whether they want to accept that agent or whether they don't trust it. And so they're trying to figure out, what information do I need in order to make this judgment? And so we're going to be bringing information foraging to that very problem. So I don't know if any of you have heard of the DARPA explainable AI project, but that's a big thing. And so we're just jumping into that now to do that. Thing number three, answer number three, we have been moving toward end user programmers or novice programmers. They're still looking at code, but we're trying to understand what's different about people, those kind of people, and the way they follow code, or if there's nothing different versus professional programmers following code. So, not a direct yes, but sort of lots of around in the territory. Now your question.
Yes, Margaret, have you seen interest on the part of the commercial software development space to implement your theories and practice in actual debugging tools, commercial tools?
There are researchers who've expressed a lot of interest. I worked a lot with IBM Research on this project. In fact, they were collaborators on some of the things that you've seen. In fact, Bonnie was a collaborator on some of the things that you've seen when she was with IBM. I know that there's some people in Microsoft that have been, Microsoft Research, that have been very interested in it. But whether it has actually infiltrated any tools, I haven't seen evidence of that. I don't know whether it will or not. Sometimes it takes a while. There's something that I did, let's see, in about 2003 that is now starting to make its way into a project, a product. It's like, really? So, yeah. Yes.
Yes. So I think my question actually followed this, this question on the experience, individual's experience. So you said in your equation you actually take out the familiarity with the code. And my question is actually about that. So we all know that when a software engineer becomes a senior software engineer, his income starts to increase. And because he's familiar with the code, with the background of this program, he can easily or quickly identify the thing. And it seems in all your study, you are more focusing on the first time people or the people with less experience in the code. And
in that code base, yes,
in
you're
that
right.
Code base, yes. And will that actually make those senior people less, advantage in their job?
So it's a good point. Foraging is sort of, shall we say, rustling around in territory where you don't quite know where the thing is to find it. And so if you know exactly where something is, because you wrote it, or because you're really familiar with the code, you're not really foraging. You know where exactly to go. So it's information foraging theory is sort of not applicable there. And so that's why all of our studies have been very experienced developers, but in a new code base. So is that answering your question?
Yes.
Okay.
That
okay.
Question.
Good. Yeah. And maybe that's a better answer to what your question was about too. Yes.
So I think you kind of answered my question too. I was asked if you work with any developers that were using test-driven development or anything like that.
We didn't do test-driven development with this. I'm trying to think if anybody else has. I don't know if anybody else has. I don't think so. But I don't see why it would be different, because test-driven development, so often, that too is just writing more code to generate these tests. And so, you have even more stuff to forage through. So, yeah. But there is something about test-driven development that maybe is different. And that is that it has quite an emphasis on output. And so when I showed you the graphs a while back about what people were paying attention to, I said code. And the things we've looked at, that's been true. But now we're actually starting to see, well, how can we take output into the equation too, in order to try to figure out whether if they're spending a lot of time with output, we can draw that into our graphs and sort of use that to heat up the methods that would be related to that, or at least seem to be related to that. And of course, a lot of output is graphics, not words. And so it's a non-trivial problem. But we've gotten some advice from an image processing, image recognition kind of guy on some ways to get started. And so we're actually experimenting with an algorithm trying now to see if, when they're paying a lot of attention to output, how that's helping to predict where they might end up going in the code. Yes.
Something kind of basic I didn't understand. So if this was stupid, this is a big glass of wine.
Oh, you're so stupid.
Yeah.
Take that off the video. I didn't mean it.
It seems like the goal of our algorithm was to predict where the developers would run. But then, as you said, and I really like your examples, there's all sorts of reasons why where they are going is wrong. So how do you connect that to actually not predicting where they're going to go, but where they should go?
Okay, that's a good question. Some people who are like fault localization reasoning people, those are people who try to figure out, well, where is the bug, and let's just take them there.
Yeah.
And so their argument is, let's just save them all that foraging. We'll just figure out where the bug is, and we'll just land them in that method, and then all will be good. But the trouble is, just landing somebody in the broken method oftentimes isn't enough, because there was knowledge you had to pick up along the way. that would inform how you would ultimately go about fixing it. So, so we aren't real convinced by that argument, but they could turn out to be right. Nobody's really tried a head-to-head test to see how much that would save and how much that would mislead and so on and so forth. So that really is kind of the answer to predicting where they should go. We think that the better approach is to try to inform them better about what lies in wait for them if they go there. So if they think they're chasing a rabbit, it would be nice to say, the rabbit is now 40,000 miles that way,
yeah.
And so at least you know what your cost is going to be. I mean, you know, like Google Maps, right? I mean, you know how far away it is, you know how many twists and turns, you know where you're going to be when you finally get there. Wouldn't it be nice if we could do that for code navigation? I mean, it's called navigation. Wouldn't it be nice if we had that sort of capability? So, yeah, fine.
But can you even predict where the bug is? I mean,
is
that even possible?
No, no, I can't. But there are fault localization people who try to do that. And then they say, you know, hey, you know, we're not too bad at it. We'll just land the programmer there. And so I think their argument is we'll just keep getting better and better and better at that. And so we can just deliver the programmer there, and then they won't have to futz around along the way. I don't know if I really buy it, but certainly in some situations I won't buy it. And so given that somebody has to forge, it'd be nice if they knew what they were going to have to pay before they paid it and what they were going to get when they finally got there. Kind of like, you know, I have this beautiful house, okay, it's beautiful, and it's only going to cost you $1. Now you haven't seen the house, but I've told you the price. Will you buy it? Only $1. Wow, you're really risk averse. Okay, there you go. Give me that $1, and then I'll show you the house. Was I lying? And oh, by the way, just give me a blank check. I'll fill in the amount. Okay, this is really what it's like for programmers. Really, it's, you know, the environment is give me a blank check, and trust me, there will be something good at the end, and then there isn't. Yeah, it's just awful. So. Yes.
Most of the stuff that you look at is negative, like something for like one particular method that was broken.
No. In at least one of the studies we've done, there have been 2 to 3 methods that had to be fixed, sometimes more. The particular studies I showed, I think that may have been true. But we've done a lot of them by now.
But you guys haven't done any studies like that? Runtime bugs is something I like.
Oh, you mean like memory leaks and
yeah.
Stuff like that? No. Yeah. No, we're still working on the easy bugs.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
So you just mentioned a little bit about the intelligent agent and applying it. Are you allowed to talk a little bit more about it? Because we all know
yeah.
Chatbots and Amazon Echo are super.
I'm totally allowed. The project starts in 3 months, so here's how much progress we've made. There, I've talked about it. So we haven't really done a great deal about that, but we have actually studied a lot about end users trying to fix their intelligent agents, trying to understand them and debug them. But what's new in the new project is we've never brought information foraging theory to bear on it. And done it in a really big time way. But my student Todd Kaliza, who I don't know, you've maybe run across his papers if you've been digging around in this space, came up with something that we called explanatory debugging of intelligent agents. And so what it is the agent explains its logic, and that's, shall we say, the source code? It's not source code, it's an explanation. But that's the thing that the user is allowed to change, is the explanation itself. Okay? And so that's the communication medium between the system and the user. And so in order to do that, the system has to be transparent enough to make all its logic, or at least a whole lot of its logic, available to the user to change. Because how can you debug something if you can't even see through parts of the logic? But how do you make it accessible for an ordinary end user who's never even done any debugging? So anyway, that's the problem that we're trying to bring information foraging theory to real soon. Yes.
So how much of this work with professional programmers has analogies with your end user programmers?
Yeah, so good question. We have done an information foraging theory study with novice programmers. We were hoping to do it with end user programmers, but we just didn't. We couldn't get enough. So anyway, with novice programmers, we're seeing the same applicability of information foraging theory. So it's still working quite well at predicting. When we get to the explainable AI project, we're going to have to deal with ordinary end users trying to make sense of this. So that'll be another way that it's a new dimension for programming. I mean, you know, obviously, Peter did it for web browsing without programmers. But, yeah. Okay, is that the end of the story? All right, then.